practical way. Behind this astonishing initiative, it is the amazing intellect of the Faculty of Technology of Kalinga University, Chhattisgarh, which is the topmost university, ranked India's best 30th university by India Today magazine, 7th best business school by the Competition Success Review, and top university in terms of student satisfaction. I, Dr. Vinita Diwan, Assistant Professor in the Department of Arts and Humanities, shows a very warm welcome to all the esteemed dignitaries, intellectuals, invited guests, faculty members, and students for sparing their valuable moments to participate in today's event. It's a tradition and culture of our country to begin any event by offering an invocation and prayer to Goddess Saraswati and take her blessings through the Saraswati Vandana. So now I request Rahul Chava sir to please coordinate for the virtual Saraswati Vandana. Sir, please. Thank you, sir. We are extremely delighted to have with us a consummate and dexterous personality as the chief guest for today's event. He is Dr. R. Sridhar, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Kalinga University. Dr. R. Sridhar is a polymath and intellect in education industry. He is a PhD in management with more than 34 years of teaching expertise in the field. He is a walking dictionary of the managerial skills. Dr. Sridhar is a dynamic training professional who thrives in making maximum use of the managerial and industrial skills to identify, develop, and conduct training programs, organizing high-end professional courses, developing efficient workforce, and motivating individuals to achieve maximum productivity. Sir, you are warmly received. And now, I request Sir to grace the function with his inspiring words. Sir, please.
Oh, thank you, madam. Respected keynote speaker, Dr. Satyaprakash Pandeji, Dr. Baiju John, Dr. Sandeep Gandhi sir, Dr. V.C. Jha sir, and all other the guests who are attending this program, all the deans of universities and all the faculties. We have observing since two decades a vast change in all the aspects of professional life. It may be companies, it may be the business, it may be a marketing, it may be the education scenario, health scenario, change. Everywhere there is a change, not only in India, it's a big, huge global change. Now, the National Education Policy, which is introduced in 2020, will change the face of education ecosystem at large extent. We may also hope to see bright young adults with innovative approaches towards work and life, instead of obsession over marks and mugging up the bookish knowledge. First time this new education policy, our national education policy, is given a larger highlight on the practical knowledge of this subject. In 1986, our late Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi introduced Operation Blackboard to strengthen the primary school system. Now the time has come to take, as per the global demand, to introduce the new educational policy of 2020, which aims at skill-oriented education system. The biggest highlight in the introduction of vocational courses, especially for children, and the day of, you know, the dream, that is backless days in schools, or especially to improve their skills right from the school level. This has given the major emphasis on new education policies. And especially for higher education, the national education policy is given equal weightage, is given to technical as well as non-technical education. Further, we as a university, Kalinga University, we are training our faculties through various programs by encouraging to pursue doctoral programs, to write national and international research paper, by offering various financial packages to the our faculties. Today's program is also an initiative is taken to train our faculties, especially in National Education Policy 2020. So on the behalf of entire Kalinga family, I welcome you all, and I hope this very varied session is going to strengthen our knowledge, will be helpful in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. I heartily welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Baiju John, sir.
Please unmute yourself.
I heartily welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Baiju John, sir, Director General, Kalinga University. He is a phenomenal personality, having 12 years of industrial experience, 19 years of academic experience, and continuing experience for 15 years in the field of research. He has done his master's in personal management from Pune University. He has contributed 28 research papers in reputed national and international journals. He is an executive fellow in management from IIM, and he holds a PhD degree in management in the area of organizational behavior and HR. Sir was in the capacity of the vice chancellor at the Max University from 2014 to 2019. And sir has also been conferred with the honorary rank of colonel by the Ministry of Defense. Sir, I welcome you into this program. I request you to bestow your best wishes and enlighten the virtual gathering through your speech. Sir, please.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It's indeed my pleasure. First of all, a warm good afternoon to Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Sridhar sir, Dr. Satya Prakash Pandey sir, my dear colleagues, all the deans, heads of the departments, and the participants. It's a very great initiative from the by the Kalinga University to keep a series of talk on national education policy. Actually, when we talk about the knowledge dissemination, we all proudly said when the glasnost and perestroika we spoke about in the 80s, talk about the openness, world coming together, the biggest thing we talked about was the knowledge explosion. The knowledge which had been disseminating since last 2000 years is exploded in last 20 years. See the beauty of this thing. But somewhere the required rate in which it has to be disseminated that went. So our Government of India, Ministry of Human Resource Development, and various agencies, they brought in, came into the picture and said that it has to be reframed and realigned. So one of the biggest challenge what the National Education Policy 2020 talks about is bringing 2 crore students who are school dropouts back to the schools. So we are talking about a realignment right from the school level, and we are talking about the functional literacy and numeracy, which we have never been talked about, because we talk about the numeracy factor again, because the time has come and the thrust of knowledge has been stressed on three things. That is, one is the knowledge, that is gyan, the other is wisdom, the pragya, and the truth, the satya. Actually, we have going through a space where we talk about pandemic, we talk about knowledge, everybody is knowledgeable, everybody is in the height of knowledge. But the thing is that what exactly we want to take and what we have to discard. The time has come, and we as a country has to stand together to build a strong nation through the virtues, values, and knowledge, what we have to inculcate into our own lives as well as to the lives of the common people and to our family members for making this country very great and strong. So I'm sure that in the deliberations done by the learned experts from the AICT and from various colleges will definitely throw light and will add value to our lives. Thank you very much. I wish you very best. Stay safe and have a pleasant learning experience. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Sandeep Gandhi, Registrar, Kalinga University. Dr. Gandhi has over 28 years of experience in the education sector. His researching mind, enthusiasm, and thirst for knowledge has driven him to embrace some of the highly prestigious and strategic positions in several renowned institutions in India and abroad. He has featured prominently as an administrative officer of an engineering college in Mathura, as a principal of management college in Gurgaon, registrar of a university in Gurgaon, and deputy vice chancellor of a university in Uganda. He is an intellectual figure with a PhD in management and an MBA with specialization in marketing and finance. He has a broad experience in the field with his active participation in multiple conferences and seminars and his expertise in conducting conferences and workshops on various management and education related topics in India and abroad. Sir, we are blessed with your esteemed presence today and we are awaiting to hear from you. Sir, please.
Thank you, Vinita ma'am, and a very warm and affectionate good morning to all the distinguished participants here. Since I hold an administrative position, I generally do not attend these intellectual sessions, but today I am here because of a very special reason, because the guest of honor, the keynote speaker, Dr. S.P. Pandey, is a dear old colleague and a very good professional friend. I am very happy to note that he is the keynote speaker today. My association with Dr. S.P. Pandey goes back more than 20 years. It was way back in 2001 and 2 in Sachdeva Engineering College in Mathura when we were working together. I was taking care of administration and Pandey sir had joined as an assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. One special incident which I would like to share with all of you here is, at that time in the early 2000s, in 2001 and 2, ragging was a very big nuisance in engineering colleges. And we were facing a very big challenge because that college was based in Agra, very close to Agra, and there were different groups of students from Bhind, Murena, Agra, Mathura, and there used to be major concerns related to ragging. I was facing that problem very seriously, but then I requested Professor Pandey to become the chief proctor of the institution. And believe me, as soon as he became the chief proctor, he took such an active approach. And within a couple of days, he changed the environment in the institution and it became a 100% ragging free campus. Dr. Deepak Mishra is also here. Dr. Rahul Mishra is here. We are all colleagues from the same institution. And it was really a very good effort on the part of Dr. S.P. Pandey. I am happy to note that he has progressed a lot in his career, and today he is heading a prestigious engineering college in Azamgarh. And I wish Pandey sir, I want to see you as the vice chancellor of some big government university in the times to come. So my good wishes to you. Now coming to the topic of today, we are all aware that the government has done this lot of deliberations for the national education policy. This is the third education policy in India. The first one came in 1968, second one came in 86, and this is the third one. There are sweeping reforms and changes in this. The discussions about the academic bank of credit, the discussion about choice-based credit system, about adding value-added courses, about bringing back the lost glory of India, all these are very, very important topics. And I'm sure that the keynote speaker, Professor Pandey, will show us the right direction and the right path in this manner. And I'm also thankful to my dear friend, Mr. Tawseef, who is joining us from Doha, Qatar. He is also an expert in the education domain, and he would also be sharing his learnings on the national education policy. So I wish all the best for this event, and thank you to the organizing team for arranging such a wonderful gathering of intellectuals for this occasion. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It's our proud privilege to have with us today Dr. Satya Prakash Pandey, Director REC Azamgarh and Additional Charge
Vinita, ma'am, you are on mute. Please unmute yourself.
Sorry, sir. It's our proud privilege to have with us today Dr. Satya Prakash Pandey, Assistant Director, REC Azamgarh, and Additional in Charge of GEC Mirzapur, UP, as the honored guest and keynote speaker for today's webinar. Professor S.P. Pandey holds a B.Tech in Mechanical Engineering from KNIT Sultanpur, UP, in 1987, and MTech in Mechanical Engineering with specialization in Automobile Engineering in 1989, and a degree of PhD in Mechanical Engineering in the area of Micro Hydropower, a renewable energy resource, from Madan Mohan Malviya University of Technology, Gorakhpur, formerly known as Madan Mohan Malviya Engineering College, Gorakhpur. Presently, he is a Margdarshak of AICT since 2018, and a member of National Board of Accreditation, NBA, in a new system of outcome-based education under Washington Accord for Tier 1 and Tier 2 since 2010. Professor Pandey has worked in Committee for NIRF, National Institutional Ranking Framework under Ministry of Human Resource Development, New Delhi. Dr. Pandey is presently the Chairman of Employer Survey Satisfaction Survey Committee of NBIU, MHRD. Professor Pandey is a member of UP State Environment Advisory Board as well. He has been awarded Bharat Sanchar Samman Award by BSNL on 1st January 2016. Prior to his current appointment, Professor Pandey was director of G.B. Pant Institute of Engineering and Technology, Pauri Garhwal, Government Autonomous Institutes. He also worked as the director of the reputed institutes like Galgotia College of Engineering and Technology, Greater Noida, IMS Engineering College, Ghaziabad, and Vishweshwaraya Group of Institutions, Greater Noida. He was also professor and head of Mechanical Engineering Department, Kumaon Engineering College, Dwarhat District, Alpura, a state government college of Uttarakhand government. He was offered assignments by two international universities, namely Al Jabal Al Kharbi University, Garden State, Libya, and Multimedia University, Malaysia, at the university level. He has around 31 years of experience in teaching and research and academic administration. He has been the member and working executive of different professional bodies like Institution of Engineers, ISTE, IAENG. He has been a member of the Board of Studies and the Dean of Mahamaya Technical University, and is a member of Research Degree Committee in Uttarakhand Technical University, Dehradun, and few other national universities. He has been a member of the Local Inquiry Committee, Nagpur University, from 1995 to 2000. He has taught a wide spectrum of courses related to mechanical engineering. He has guided many PhD theses on mechanical engineering and has published more than 35 research papers in Scopus, AICT, UGC CARE, and in many national and international reputed journals, and more than 30 publications in national or international referred conference proceedings. He has participated in more than 36 workshops, refresher courses, and national and international seminars in nation and abroad as the guest speaker, invited speaker, plenary speaker, session chair or co-chair, and paper presenter. Professor S.P. Pandey is a principal investigator with the paid consultancy work on ambient air quality monitoring of the UP Pollution Board, Lucknow, for the Hapur City. He is involved in technology business incubation under MSME New Delhi. He has delivered many invited talks, lectures, keynotes, addresses, and Skype talks to the PNG University, Australian Subcontinent, and Texas University, USA. Sir has an affiliation as an AICT Margdarshak, as NIRF committee member, NPA expert, chairman of NPIU MHRD, director REC Azamgarh, additional charge GC Mirzapur, GB Pant Engineering College, Pauri Garhwal, Galgotia Engineering College, and is involved in consultancy work of UP Pollution Board and many more coming up in future. Dr. Pandey is here with us today to address the session on implementation of National Education Policy NEP 2020 under AICT Training and Learning Theme ATL of reinvigorating human capital through excellence in education and multilingualism. So now I request Sir to please begin his session. Sir, you are most welcome.
Thank you, madam. Good morning to all of you. Honorable Vice Chancellor of Kalinga University, Director General, then Registrar Dr. Sandeep Gandhi, organizers and participating faculty in this webinar on new education policy. I'm very happy to see again Dr. Gandhi, and he said a few memory things which brought me back in the 2000. Where he definitely he's a very cool and very efficient administrator, no doubt about that. And something is there at that time, and he was also their main source of the controlling the whole activity. Unless until you don't get the support from administration, things will not be very easy for us. Anyway, I'm very thankful to AICT for just giving me the panel for the expert on the session number fifth. Basically, that is the standard procedure what they have done through ATL, that they have got their own experts, and the experts are delivering the issues of NP, new education policy, you can say national education policy. Here I'll just start my presentation. Just wait. The presentation is visible on the screen, or?
Yes, sir, it's visible. We can see your screen.
You can see, yeah?
Can you see the screen?
No, it is moving also.
No, sir, presentation is not visible.
Yes, sir, presentation is not there. It's actually something.
Not visible.
Still, it is not visible?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Wait, it's so just wait. Okay.
Just wait 1 minute.
Now it is coming, madam.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. It is visible.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Sorry for this problem.
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
It is moving also.
Yes, also, sir. Just do the full screen.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, sir. It's okay now.
And it is clear.
Yes.
Oh, sorry. I am very sorry for this particular mistake from this side. Anyway, I am just coming to the same point. So I am very thankful to the AICT who had initiated this particular task of informing the faculty members and stakeholders of all the institutions across the India regarding this particular important topic of your reinvigorating human capital through excellence in education and multilingualism. And no doubt it is the time when we need to discuss about these terms, because after so many years of 28 years, new education policy came in picture. Already Dr. Gandhi and Director General informed that in 88, the last second NPS, this National Education Policy, was in picture. But in 92, there was a small modification and some amendments were done by at that time, Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao. So this is a very much important. I am coming directly to the topic behind. This is the three-part topic, where I'll present the, because we are talking about the educational system, Kalinga University, the education domain leaders in that Chhattisgarh area. So definitely it has to be the related with education and then technical education, because AICT is there. And definitely multilingualism is the another one. But prior to that, one slide I'll start with my very favorite theme that we can see from Rabindranath Tagore vision. He has written some poem, and that is a very popular poem. And in that he had expressed his vision about a country. That country should be like this. If we can see that where the mind is without fear and head is held high. And I feel that once you will go through this vision, I feel that each and every university of the country, even the nation, should have the same vision. Because university and college, if they have got the same vision of Rabindranath Tagore, who have imagined in his poem long back, it will solve the purpose. Where the mind is without fear and head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken into the fragment by narrow domestic walls, where worlds come out from the depth of the truth. Another 3 points he had mentioned in his poem is where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary sand of dead habits. Then where the mind, minded lie led forward by three into ever-widening thought and action. Into the heaven of the freedom, my father, let my country awake. So definitely the vision is very clear that each and every has to, one has to be in the same line, the country, the college, the university, whatever the responsible areas and responsible things are there, it should be in that one. On the basis of this particular theme, the finance ministry definitely planned the budget in the their own different pillars, but we are only concerned with the fourth pillar, because whenever there are presentations or there are certain budget is to be presented in any government, they have to base the pillars also. First pillar is very important, no doubt, health and well-being, where it is important for each and every citizen of the country should be healthy enough and he should be well-being with all the family members and whatever the responsible citizens are there. Here, government has to take care. Then second, fiscal and financial capital. Then infrastructure comes in, inclusive the development of aspirational India. Then reinvigorating human capital. Definitely, it is the important one where we will talk for about 1 hour. And then innovation and R&D. It is behind that. It is there, which is very much concentrated from all the stakeholders of the technical education at present. Then minimum government and maximum governance. This is the focus area again, where e-office and other concepts are being already implemented in many sector of the states. Here we'll be just getting the idea of what is the meaning of reinvigorate means. It is nothing but to give a new energy to something or to give strength to. What happened, if you see the 30 years, 35 years back, and now you compare with the present scenario, there is only need to just motivate every system or every stakeholders in the same way what it was 35 years back. Meaning by they need, or we have to add the new energy and to give strength. That was the that is the concept of this new budget four number head, where you can see human capital. It is an intangible asset not listed in on a company balance sheet. Meaning by human capital is the, no doubt, a human being are there. We have to make the human beings into human capital. If we are in university or in institutes, then students are also a human being, and they are admitted as a student. The teachers used to prepare them to convert them in human capital. Later, definitely, they will be there are the organizations and the training other, that will come later. But that is, they are not listed in the company's balance sheet. And includes things like employees' experience and skill. Then the human capital is perceived to have relationship with economic growth, productivity, and profitability. Because economic development of any nation, we know that education is very important. And in that education, technical education definitely plays an enormous role. And that way it is something like that, that particular economic growth has to maintain productivity and profitability has to be there. Then like any other asset, human capital can depreciate through long period of unemployment, because a person is ready, a human capital is already there, but if he do not get the job and he stayed for a longer time of unemployment, then definitely that asset is there which you can depreciate, and the inability to keep up with the technology and innovation. For example, 20 years back, some technology came, and now we are here, and if I am a very well competent in my own area, I should be tap up, or I should be cope up with the technology and innovation changes. I should be able to command the things, and I can transform or inform to the students. Then pillar of this human capital, we can see that developing skill in population speeds up the process of human capital formation. Meaning by earlier, we can see only knowledge-based education was there. Some 25 years back, 30 years back, you can say knowledge-based. Only knowledge is being given in certain government sectors where they're dominating in every way. Only written examination were there. And then on the merit, persons used to get appointment. Now, there was no concept of skill. But now the current, since last 25, 30 years, the skill has came in the picture, and developing skill in the population, definitely it will speed up the process of human capital formation, because unless a person is not being skilled, with the addition of the knowledge, no doubt knowledge comes first, but skill comes second. It is 50-50%. Then how capital formation will be there? So that is why it is very much required. We can see three components of this particular drive, that is education, health, and technical knowledge. Education is no doubt very important for social, economic, and political transformation of any society, where it is having a lot of government scheme also. This Saksharta Abhiyan, then Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao, some enormous programs are, you can see the website. And that education is important from each and everyone, or you can say every citizen of the country. So definitely that will be clubbing with the economic and political transformation will definitely happens in that particular society. So that way education comes on the number one. Health being is the another one. Health is the there if unless until we are not healthy, how the particular drive can be attained. So health sector is a different one, but it comes under the support of the formation of the human capital formation. And then technical knowledge, because definitely technical knowledge brings about new methods of production, leads to innovation and development of new equipment. Because technology has changed, we know the new methods are in there, they're in the market for production line, leads or to inventions are there, so many patents and so many activities are being done at every layer of the educational system, whether it is IIT, NIT, or state government college, private institutions, private universities, and a lot of new things. Because while visiting the different NITs, when I used to visit for the NBA, NIT, the Raipur, even I visited in 2016. So definitely each of the students' projects and students' involvement in that area appears to a contributing, dominating factor, the factor for this area of technical knowledge. And definitely country is going ahead up in upward direction in that way. Then economy should spend more resource on education and technical skill. Meaning, unless until we not get finance for this, it is a little bit challenging for each and everything. Economy needs to be supported. Now, key takeaways in a very short, we can discuss about the, it is nothing but a human capital involves the investment in education, which converts human being into the human capital. And definitely if human capital is there, it represents the enhanced labor productivity. Fortunately, today is 1st May, it is called in India, it is Labor Day, but in international level, it is International Labor Day. So that labor is a vary, it has cost is vary as per the skill and as per the ability to perform the productivity. Investment in the education and the job training, health, migration, informations are the sources of human capital information. Because a person is there, human capital is ready, because the students have been converted to the human capital. And definitely after that, doctor, engineer, and other sector of the particular responsible persons are in market. So definitely they need what support? They need job training, which is to be done either in institute or by the employers. Then health factor also to be taken from either the same employers also take care that a particular aspect, migration informations, or the source of human capital information. The information should be there available for each and every employer. And unless until we are not having the information, how we can see that what is the status of our this human capital? Then it is the whatever the investment we are doing, any organization, whatever the expenditure they are doing in these terms, These are the elementary terms. In the broader way, we'll come to the later. It is considered as efficient and growth enhancing. In the earlier slide, I said that it does not reflect in the balance sheet of the company, but whatever the expenditure the company is doing or our nation is doing in this particular aspect, it is always considered to be very much efficient and growth enhancing. Growth will be there, but the particular figure, it is said, it will be tough to calculate on paper. But human development is based on the idea that education and health are integral to human well being, because the only efficient working is possible, which leads to increased productivity. If a employee is well and he is very much sound in his health, his working efficiency during 8 hours of the working in the organization will be very, very much as compared to a person who is not so much healthy as compared to the previous one, and he often in a problem. So definitely it is there, which is going to affect. From this particular slide, we can just see the concept clear view of the human capital. Here, one, we can see there are the human capital puts the monetary value on the knowledge, then skills, competencies, and attributes of a person. We consider students also, because the university system, in a college system, we consider students as a human capital, because they are being given a lot of attention from the management of the organization or institutional heads. They all are contributing a lot of money in these areas. For example, knowledge, definitely for that they are appointing very good faculty members. Skill, they are just collaborating their leading skill collaborators, because each and every branch of engineering have got different requirement of a skill. It cannot be same. IT skill is another, the mechanical skill I'll talk in later in slide. It is different, civil different, computer different, something like that. So the expenditure comes to the university or college, but they are definitely attributes. Attribute of a person also they used to send for the different courses and different programs. All of them, these are the factors which enables individual to work and therefore produce something of economic value. We can see the textbook are there, minds they are there, then mechanical, then the health sector, then design, other aspects are there. They all contributes to, then finally it comes to the individual human capital. Very simple, because in a institution like the Kalinga University, there are students, they all are there for certain years, and during the year of their stay in the campus, definitely additions of these attributes and other written words definitely add and convert them in human capital once they're coming out after 4 years or 3 years or 2 years of their course. Here we can see your personal human capital affects your employment prospects. Definitely, it is very much understood that if we have been informed, we have been given definitely so many attention from the institutions, definitely it will be directly affecting our employment prospect and personal well-being also. To calculate your individual human capital, you take your earnings today. Now we work and we get salary, and definitely it is the something which we can calculate and add what you are likely to earn in future. This is affected by the following steps. You can see education is there. From the education, a qualification comes in a human being. What we can call a human being will be qualified and he will be converted into the human capital. Maybe engineer, maybe doctor, maybe a advocate like that, maybe a management competent person. But prior, in addition to the qualification, trainings are being imparted, given to the particular human capital to make more effective and working life. After that, working life will be there. And in that, in addition to that, you can see the different right side sickness, which should be there, which should be taken care of from the employer or organizations, because it will involve the money, because we should have, for example, a university have got dispensary in the campus. Almost all bigger institutions are having, so definitely they will appoint doctors, something like that. Whatever the involvement of money is there, that is also contribute. Then continuing to work, definitely if these things on the left side, together with the well-being and good health, then work will be there, which will be continuing nature. And after that, definitely retirement is there. and parenthood will be there afterwards. So these are the concept, very clear diagram we have shown that human capital, what is, and it is a value which cannot be calculated, which is very difficult to calculate this particular investment, but definitely it will be enhancing the productivity and it is always an efficient one. Now, essence of this new national education policy, we have already informed that this is the third education policy came in our country, which has got this particular clear step focused on the individual layer. You can see the first one, that student's holistic development. What happens in the earlier, if we can see 25 years back again, there was no such system of 5 + 3 + 3, 4 in the different fundamental A stage, then intermediate, then elementary, like that. So according to that, the capacity of the student and the potential and interest of the particular student of the class 3, class 5, class 8, like that, class 10th, different categories are there, different students options are there. It is not necessary that from after 8th, the student is supposed to go to the 10th, or it is not necessary that after 10th, student should go to 12th. They have got they have designed the various courses that if a student is class 8 pass and he do not want to continue, he don't have any interest in the higher studies, then there are options. There are different vocational courses already available where this particular achievement of the particular person can be there. It is the China system, because China skill and all issues are long back, they have implemented in their education system 15, 20 years back. Now, the second point, we talk about multidisciplinary system. Definitely, this education policy says about multidisciplinary system. It is not like that now I'm a computer person and I'll not go knowing the mechanical, I do not want to know the electrical. It is something gone now. When the physics, chemistry, mechanical, mathematics, each and everything is interdisciplinary now. And each and every has to work together. And definitely, electives are there, and those new things have been introduced by AICT in this incoming, I think, this particular session of new handbook, it is going to make more elaborative way. Then emphasize the conceptual understanding. It should be focused in this particular NPS 2020. Flexible learning environment. Yes, definitely, environment is always necessary to learn, which should be flexible, that how a person can get the better learning, because learning makes earning. That is very simple funda. Then extensive use of technology. Whatever the technology we are having in our country, it should be done and it should be used in up to the maximum level. If each and everything department has got their own technical supports. For example, I'll take very simple, although this is the broad way of the, but I will take the example of, in many institutions, I found that this central workshop, electrical labs, computer labs are there. What they are utilizing, only they are utilizing for their lab of students. In a week, 2 days, they will open, and or for maximum 4 days, if they are having a 30-30 batch, something like that. But they are not using this in the two-tier system. I mean, they cannot, because they can be used for just giving the training for the skilled persons nearby society in the second shift. For example, from 5 to 8, definitely a diploma holder, a ITI person who want to get themselves upgraded, you can use those center, that you can convert those labs in the center of this excellence. That is the basic theme behind that. Then critical thinking and creativity is necessary for each and every students. I'll talk, because we are talking about AICT affiliated institute and AICT education policy that has got clear mandate. And respect for diversity and local context, multilingualism, and including curriculum, pedagogy, and policy. This is the area where these things are being focused. And other essence, we can see equity and inclusion in higher education. Earlier it was there, but it has got very clear vision in this particular NEP 2020. Research, innovation, and ranking, definitely research is there. Each and every engineering college, university, bigger NITs, or whatever IIT system, each and everywhere this activities is being involved, innovations are there. Rankings, everyone wants the ranking in NRF, at least a first attempt, they want ranking at least to just, now because the employer also looks for these things, what is the ranking of your university or working, ranking of the institute. And that's why it is the mandatory, it's going to be mandatory that if you are, this three concept has to be there. Integrated higher education system, I'll give you the example. Just 15 days back or 10 days back, I gone through a news that two IITs have just started a joint program. That one, for example, one though both one guide will be from IIT Delhi, one from IIT Guwahati, and the student may be from some other institute and co-guide, and like that, both IIT will help the particular PhD program. They have signed MOU, and this is an integrated higher education system. Their infrastructure, their resource, talent of the faculty can be given to the required domain. For example, any institution is going to have the MOU with the IITs, they are supporting also. Governance and regulations are the focus area of essence of NEP 2020, and promotion of Indian language, art and culture. This comes under the multilingualism, because promotion of Indian language is mandatory. We see the different, here I can see the participant, many friends of South India are in the particular Uttarakhand, South India, then this particular Maharashtra, they are on the line. What we feel that whenever this promotion of the language for across the country has to be there, because up to 10th, up to 5th, or up to some level, the local language has to be taught to the students, and it is to be informed up to the 8th and 10th, and some sort of they can be given in very well information in their own language. That will come to the later. Here we can see the skill, it is the skill development which universities, NITs, IIT, and industries, MSME in their near vicinity, they have got it. Now we can see a renewable energy system. I see in many NITs, wherever I had gone for the visit, this system exists almost. In some we'll get a renewable energy, some defense sector, some mining, some other type of things. Cyber security is a renewable energy system. Is very, we can see there's a lot of potential in all this solar system, this biomass, wind and fuel cell and hydrogen fuel and like that. So there are the system which is working very well as a center of excellence, definitely under that skill development. That I was talking about, the utilization of your mechanical workshop, electrical workshop. For example, now in a college, there is no electrical student, or in a university, there is no electrical, but investments are there. Why not to use and why not to convert those facilities for a useful purpose? Definitely, it will create general revenue also. And on the other side, you are doing the support to the requirement of the society also. Then cyber security and computer networking, defense sector, many defense research, and they all are being taking place. Definitely NITs and IITs, industries are, research park comes under this area. We should be knowing that research park is nothing but to develop these type of centers in IIT Chennai. It is the biggest research park of the country, where BHEL, NTPC, this Gas Authority of India Limited, they have opened their own center of excellence in their campus in IIT Chennai. The students and faculty used to their office to go to their R&D in the campus, but only IIT Chennai have given the space. Yes, this space you want, this is for NTPC, and their trainer, their teachers, their students go to the project. Their employees take the help from the university, IIT Chennai, and they used to, like that. Many new IITs also in the plane, in the mode of just getting that type of research park. So that comes under this all activities. Then AICT efforts have been taken over from the current present chairman, AICT Professor Anil Sas Budesal. He's a visionary chairman of AICT, and since 2016, once he took the charge, he had initiated a lot of tasks in order to revamp the engineering curriculum. We can see, and we must be observing many curriculum, many circulars from AICT. You see the portal, you will see the AICT just now they had implemented that NCC should be elective. That is a very creative and positive mindset of our chairman, sir, and to impart the requisite skill set to the student to enhance the employability of engineering student. Here I'll say one very important word we have just see here, employability. Once that particular revamping is done to make the to enhance the employability of engineering student, so definitely this is word looks to be simple, but it is the most important and most required term at present scenario. I'll tell in a detail. It has approved an action plan with the following objective: that induction training program has to be conducted, that each and every institution is conducting the induction training program, revision of curriculum, then mandatory internship, yes, second year, third year, final year, all summer vacations, the mandatory internship are being done, and yes, definitely it helps a lot. Industry readiness, yes, industry has to be having a very close interaction with the organizations of this educational organization, what we can say. Because the particular, whatever the technology is changing in place, it is in the industry only. So you can have the MOUs and interaction of the industry, sending the student for your BTech project to the nearby industry. A lot of work, enormous work one can do. Then mandatory accreditation. This is the very important, because unless institute is not getting accreditation, though in coming years, the companies are saying, sir, please, mail your accreditation letter of NBA so that we can plan to come to your campus for campus intro. So in bigger organization now they have implemented, like Yamaha, then TCS, many bigger, although TCS is coming in the pool campus, and otherwise if they want to come to the individual campus, the accreditation is very simple word, actually nothing but it is the quality parameter, which normally it is a certificate which gives the certification for the quality program. That if you have got 6 branches and you want only one branch to be giving for accreditation, that may be a CS. So definitely once you will get the certificate of the quality that your CS branch of the university has got quality parameter, they are fulfilling it. It may be for 5 years, it may be for 3 years, depending upon the input and preparations and requirement of the different criteria, 10 criteria of your requirement from NBA. Then AICT is revamping the engineering education again. It is the second slide. Here we can see strengthening institution to produce high quality engineer for better employability, and how it will be affected. And definitely it will be having a very close relation with effective relationship, that is collaborations with the industry definitely, and self-discipline. Self-discipline is the very important term, because unless until it is not attained, how this relationship will be maintained with the industrial collaboration, we used to call it. Then workplace skill, it includes technology skill, communication, and resource management. That one should be having a skill to use the technology. I am a mechanical person, I should know the how to use my skill of mechanical related. Then communication, yes, definitely I need to communicate well in writing or in verbal. In each and every communication has got its own different sub brackets. Resource management, yes, definitely I need to understand how management of resource can be done. It cannot be a wastage of money by asking bigger and bigger equipment, and what is the utility actually, what the objective of the particular requirement. That management of the resource is very much required. I saw in many bigger institution of the government, so and they have 80 lakhs, 20, 90 lakhs equipments are there in the lab, but if you ask that how many times they are using the year, so you will not believe, and very less. It is some equipments are not opened after the purchase. Very, so those things are there, which is something disturbing. But definitely, if an organization or educational institution comes in this line, persons are good also. Then applied management, it involves the critical thinking. Definitely application skill through model curriculum. AICT has drafted model curriculum, which is implemented, and many universities and institutions have already adopted. In that curriculum, current demand of the particular courses have been introduced as a minor subject. For example, with the computer main, they have got IoT, and then big data, then cyber security, and like that. There are 6, and in a different university, surprisingly, the seats are being filled completely, no doubt about minor, and that concept came from that model curriculum. Then scaling up for PG education and demand driven research and development and innovation. Here, what we observed since last few years, that students don't have interest in the PG education. If a student comes out BTech, normally their first interest is going to a good job, either civil services, provincial services, or good company. But now the trend is changing, because it is almost something now paid one, in where good scholarships are there and now students are getting some concept, yes, I should do the PG program. So in the 2-3 years, 4 years, it has changed. But the demand-driven research and development is needed, because at present time, what do you want the research and development? For example, this in the current situation, why it is demand driven research I'm talking. In current pandemic of COVID, we see, we are talking about this abroad, that they are giving the vaccine, they are providing. So if such type of research is there in the country, in the overall setup, so this is the demand, and once it is established in the particular nation, definitely it will solve the purpose for years to come. Establishing the center of excellence for focused thematic research, definitely. Again, it is the particular area where, because I'll tell you the example, if you have got the research, yes, 1.5 crore equipment have been purchased, and the PhD guide left the college, he joined some other NIT, and then there was no PhD student. The reason asked, why you have purchased 1.5 crore equipment? The person said, yes, PhD program was necessary, so that particular. So, but the PhD guide, always the student have completed, that particular equipment of 1.5 crore is wasted. So training of faculty for effective teaching is very much important. And enhancing institutional and system management effectiveness and capacity building to the strengthening management. Now, AICT is monitoring these things also from their own setup of programs and general participation. Now, very important things, which I call it as imperatives. This is very important, very urgent for all of us, because all of us needs to see that in engineering education system, must translate these challenges through a quality response. Very much required. We can see the world of accelerating multidimensional change. Here it is a multidimensional change is taking place. Our engineering education must translate this challenge of whatever it is, multidimensional change, in the correct way. Then shift to the knowledge economy is also there. Here again, our education system of engineering has to catch up and to ensure that we are in the correct direction of the knowledge economy. And world is without border at present. So definitely no border is there, because technology moves here and there, revolution in the information and communication technology. You see this ICT term, I'll tell you very in a very brief, that this ICT terms came in picture in world in 1980. And in 1980, UK introduced this information and communication technology in their national curriculum. And once they had implemented national curriculum, it became a focus of attention for educational institution for research and development in ICT. In India, it came in 2002. In India, once it came in 2002 or 2005, in between 2000. So a lot of revolutionary in this changes of the technology takes place in our country. We can see an enormous activity under the AICT banner. Here I am in Noida, and I am interacting with the persons from across the country, Southern Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, right in Maharashtra. It is a very good. This is only ICT where we are now. Today the lockdown is everywhere, but in the lockdown it is not like that it is not it is affected, not at all. So definitely we have to see that technology has to be very much used, and that engineering education must translate this one. Now we have talked about the low employability. Employability first we talk about, that human capital is there, investments are there from organizations, from making the person competent or whatever. But after that employability, if it is there, it is a general perception. Since last few years, that employability have become, you can say, a little bit in, or you can say the situation of a country in the employability condition is something needs to look into. Although the social sites and other sites have contributed a lot, that a job nahi hai, it is not like that. Jobs are there. But we have to see what are the concerns for the low employability, if at all it is there. That is the very serious issue for human capital, because we are talking about investing the money from the government under the pillar number 4. And definitely it is the giving the new energy or to giving their strength to human capital, definitely through education, we have to very much see that employability has to be on the higher side. And definitely there are ways, and demographic disaster rather than dividend, then this makes a crucial issue and center a focus in technical education. Few years back, NESCOM survey was very much known to each and every one of us, that this is that 25% of the engineering graduates of the country are employable. And this matrix survey says for MBA that 20% are employable. Now see, the judge the institutions on the employability enhancement rather than the placement. The way I am writing this particular word, that we are only writing this 50% placement, 80% placement, 90% placement. But if we can see that how much percentage of students are employable, then that will be definitely better. Because if they are employable, 60% employability and this placement will definitely increase. So focused should be the institute who have got the good figure of employable students. And that is why we should judge the student that what is the employable strength of the students. And the typical defects what I observed in various institutions of the general way in the from all over the across the different states. I am talking about some university, government university, for example. There is a delay in the evaluation, and I'm talking about the technical university especially. Delays in the evaluation and the preparation of result, because affiliation institutions are there definitely, and guild evaluations are there, which takes time, and results also another one. Unbalanced structure of examination. It is not uniform in general. So typical defects makes the contribution to the, you can say, employability factor. Or you can say students become employable, and if these things can be removed, these defects can be removed, definitely it will be an addition to make the employability in a better dimension. Then behavior of a teacher within and outside classroom. If a teacher is there, very much very clear that what is the behavior of his inside the classroom, and once he come out from the classroom, though definitely behavior is something which should be in line. Teacher's inability to understand the student psychology and learning curve. Students are there, we who came to us for just learning something. Now we have to see and we have to understand their psychology first and their learning curves also. A student cannot be meritorious, a student may be meritorious, one can be mediocre. So if a mediocre student comes to a person, to teacher, and brilliant, so at least there has to be some understanding that he needs more care and personal attention rather than in it. So these things is there, which are the defects we have considered defect, and that has to be removed by the institutions and universities. And normally persons are doing better also. Then inefficient administrative process are leading to mistakes in students' admission, registration, record keeping, collection of fees, generation of results. Because in university, if you see the bigger institutions, bigger university, you see the students moves here and there for each and every papers. They are not getting paper. He goes to one clerk, he says, kal aana, parso aana, like that. It is not a single window system, ki morning mein aapne diya, and the person will say by evening, go with the solution. After 2 hour or 3 hour, just go with the solution. Don't come to university again. If it is the system, then it will help a lot. Then inefficient laboratory management. Laboratories are there. This equipments are kept. Equipment have got cost. And the investment is there from management side. But the management of this particular laboratory, meaning by how it is managed, how it can be better utilized for the students. It cannot be only for practical purpose. Now the days have gone that you are only showing the for practical. Now that laboratory can be used in a different way. Now add the value added equipment side support. What that equipment can do more, what information can be drawn more in that particular equipment by changing some diagram, by changing some manufacturing technology, by some other experimental output can be taken like that. Then inadequate maintenance of building and infrastructure. So these are the few defects which needs to be removed if we are talking about that. Yes, definitely, a very clear opinion from general is that our quality program is not working right now. Why it is not? You can see the scenario. Lack of shared mental model of quality in our nation. If one university is having very good quality model, it should be shared. It should be shared to the required university. But there is no harm. There is no harm for the NITs to just give the sub mental model to the nearby university. So that way, the particular, if it is there, so definitely more and more informations and good quality model can be introduced to the system and the nearby, at least minimum. For example, I'm talking about Jaipur, then Jaipur nearby place can utilize the NIT Jaipur facility and model of the quality, whatever that they have done it. So those, although 5 years back, they had introduced this concept, they called all the private vice chancellors, and they have, at that time, I.K. Bhatt sir was director there, 5 to 7 years back. And then at that time, he introduced that, yes, each and every private vice chancellors are invited for this, utilizing this particular lab of NIT Jaipur. And more or less, many private university took the advantage of that particular drive of Dr. I.K. Bhatt sir. Lack of shared values and vision. Definitely here again, values and visions are there, but it should be shared among all the stakeholders. Stakeholders means students, parents, management, UGC, AICT, industry, employers, all are known as to be stakeholders. So that values and visions of the organization should be known to each and everyone. Sometime we see that vision of the institute or university is not known to the student or the faculty. So if it can be shared in a different on a different platform, definitely it should be there. Compliance rather than commitment. Here it is very very important point. We can see we should not focus about compliance. We should be focused only for the commitment. What I want to say that if I only compliance, the AICT requirement of teacher student ratio is should not be there. Only for compliance, we should not say that it is since it we have to comply the faculty cadre ratio or student faculty ratio, so we should appoint. It is not like that. That is very complete. That is the minimum requirement. That a minimum 1 to 20 you can have, but if you are having 1 to 15, 1 to 12, who have been stopped? Definitely better it will come if you we should be committed for compliance rather than compliance word. So if we are committed, yes, ki compliance hona hai, isme bhi bahut achhe faculty ko rakhna hai, like that. So the commitment is needed in making the compliance. And then we can see steel enforced concrete. Here silos are very much clear that faculty departments are not talking to the other departments in general. If an university system is there or an engineering college, the SIS faculty will not talk to the mechanical or applied science faculty, do not go to the different branches. They are not interacting in general. And then in the same way, institutions are not talking to other institutions. In the university also do not talk to the other university. That what is going on, whether we can come together, we can have some good work, this technology is there in our university, what is new thing in going on in your system, let's jointly work together. So this type of things is missing, and it is mandatory also to make the quality program working. The non-systematic approach to implementation, because implementation has to be there. If whatever we have planned, if it, the implementation has to be at a ground level. Otherwise, what will happen? We have got the things in on paper, unless until it is converted, and it should be useful for the students, because they are the our you can say customer also, and they are after 4 years they will be our product also. Then senior administrators with complete incomplete transformation leadership skill. Because if leadership is there, it should be having all transformational information skill is required. If I am a leader, so it is mandatory for me. I have to inform to the persons, yes, this is the vision, go ahead. Then inability to learn collectively. That is also another area where we see that it can be done and improvement. Then faculty affecting quality of technical education. Management commitment is there, no doubt about. Management used to have a very good commitment because they have established their setup and they have got their own organization, so definitely they will be committing. But there are certain areas which needs discussion, and normally they take care. Faculty quality is very much important, because I feel that faculty are really asset. Infrastructure is second, third point we can see. Normally, management or college feels that infrastructure they consider to be their first asset. It is not like that. We see infrastructure depreciate. After some time, the value of the definitely you are painting, denting, and so many things you'll be involving, but faculty will not be there who have got any depreciation. They are only asset of the every educational system. That is why faculty quality and faculty and at least they should not be considered as an employee. They are the part of the system. Then industry interaction is very much mandatory, that whatever the branch you have got in your industry, in university or college, each and every branch, even first year applied science, chemistry, physics, and each and every one should have as much as possible industry interaction, because each and every industry will have its own specific product, each specific working methodology, technology, support. So one can go for different interaction through MOU, no doubt. A student has to be there, teachers has to be trained in that industry. They have to make compulsory one month summer training in the industry. Some 15 years back, I was told that Hyderabad, because friends are here also from Andhra Pradesh. So once they said ki here teachers are going to the industry for 1 month summer training. It is a time of 2008. See, the particular in the last 3-4 years, 6 years, we have also made the compulsory in our system. Wherever I had been director, I had supported this view, and faculty members used to go for at least 1 month industry training, and they used to return with the particular their project report, then video lectures, and their whole pura complete video, and they have to present in front of all the faculty members what they have learned in one, so that they can inform to the students. Until faculty will not go to the industry, how they will be informing to the student? Industry needs students also. In the reverse way, industry persons can be trained in the engineering college or university, because there are many employee of the industry who needs software training. Industry don't have softwares, latest software which in universities and engineering colleges are having. So you can plan the reverse also, that industry officers can be given good program for MBA management training program. Their staff who have got diploma, ITI, they can be called to the college, can be given good lecture on their skill, can be taken to the different labs, like that. Then the research and development area is there, which definitely, if it is better, definitely quality is going to attain. Student quality is no doubt about that. The student quality matters a lot. But definitely, if a student come during a tenure of 4 years of his stay in the campus, quality from first year to final year can be modified and can be magnified in a better scale. Academic processes has to be established, and academic processes, whatever it is there in the system, it should be there and it should be reflective. Faculty training is necessary. That's I said, continuous improvement should be there. Library resources should be available. For example, virtual library, so many things has come in the market, and in the technology area, you can see that one. Now, prerequisite of quality, I'll take this few points, that in order to able to impart the quality education, our education system has to have followings. If a university is there, definitely academic council is there, then syllabus one has to form by themselves only. So definitely quality syllabus has to be introduced. In one of the particular inspection of NBA, I went to very reputed university. They said there are certain important particular syllabus. I found that particular components were not there. I asked why the syllabus, because engineering services exam contains the questions from this particular component, and you have eliminated that particular syllabus part, particular subject content part. They said, no, sir, we don't, our students go to abroad maximum. But after some time, we in afternoon meeting, we found that most of them were preparing competitions, GATE and all. And then quality faculty. Quality faculty, definitely we have talked about this one. Quality faculty is must, but the quality of faculty, what you are getting, you can contribute to the better direction. Then quality teaching and evaluation. Teaching pedagogies are changing very fast. They have changed a lot in all, both theory and practical aspect. Though particular that teaching quality has to be maintained and to be in line with the, for example, blending teaching is now demanded and will be demanded in future. Blending teaching, for that it should be efficient, it should be well plant well delivered lecture, if it has to be there. Then evolution, if I am taking online test, then evolution matters a lot. In person also, if it is a physical evaluation, then also what we are doing the evaluation, whether students have written the correct answer or whether it needs some, we have to identify the errors also. We have to write error, the mistakes also, so that a student can see that what mistake I have did that I could not get the marks. Then quality research, quality infrastructure, and quality character. What I'll say, this quality and number, once we are talking about, if we focus on quality, then number does not matter. But if we do not follow the quality, also number does not matter. So whatever the best possible thing is, that we can maintain these particular terms, and quality is there. Here, prerequisite of quality, you can see that these four components are very, very clear, that academic research eminence has to be there. Competence, yes, it is to be there in the each and every faculty members. They are the major, because I said earlier that faculty is the asset, not infrastructure of any educational organizations. So if they are asset, so these four things, they should have three things they should have in their own reflection, that academic research eminence, competence, and reflective character of teaching. Shortage of quality, not the number, it perhaps most worrisome. That is the concern at that time, that we don't have this site in the particular, in a required stream. Here again, we see the another slide, that teacher-student ratio, model of teaching, interactive and participatory character, innovating teaching methods, regularity of classes, students' feedback is very important. How many times we used to work on the feedback of a student? If a student needs some, give some comment, we have to implement at least twice or thrice in a year it needs. And honestly, working on the feedback of a student is very much important. Regular and continuous assessment, fair, objective, and transparent evaluation. Third word is very important, that transparent evaluation is to be there. Now I have talked about the quality character. Character of a faculty, if I am talking about, that is very simple, that value system. Sensibility, integrity has to be there. Doing relevant engineering, whatever the relevancy has been given in our own engineering area, it is to be relevant. And education system has an instrument for improving of life. Definitely, if it is well equipped, definitely our life will be improved and better. Infrastructure, each and every institutions have better infrastructure, no doubt. Classrooms, labs, computer networking, and library. Now here I'll talk about certain imbalances. One, technical education, because we are talking about this human capital one side. We are talking about this finance minister have invested this budget, or they have presented budget in the fourth column, human capital. And human capital, we say the employability, and then it involves the, you can say, quality. So definitely we have to see that quality in education, where it is to be, where are the these gaps. So imbalances, if we can see in the technical education in our country, first is very clear that quality of any system is possible only by getting optimum balance among various competing demand of any system. A lot of imbalance is there. We can see imbalance, that imbalance we are talking about present time. I'll take a very, very simple example, that at present time only CS branch, IT branch, and general admission, each and everywhere you see minor. Now the balance of the branch has to be also there. Earlier I said, by just saying this employability in mechanical, civil, and electronics, electrical, it is not there. It is not like that. Jobs are there. Yes, definitely we have to work. We have to work for that. And if we have worked, definitely there will be not be any problem for this. So balancing has to be there. The imbalances are there. In Ayurveda, doctor, if you go to any Ayurveda, he will just touch your nadi and say, yes, there is imbalance in your pitta and other this aspect of this. You are not well. It needs medicine. So that is a very simple concept. In imbalance in any of the things, in human being, if it is there, it is not a good sign. If it is in technical institutions, it is not a good sign. So we have to see that there should be minimum or no imbalance. Now NIRF is talking, universities are very much ready for NIRF. There are universities or there are states where admission from other state students are very much almost nil. So there is an imbalance of the students taking admission in your university or college, Whereas this NIRF gives good marks for that category of their five parameters. And that those five parameters almost involves many of the things which comes under this slide. So this particular thing should not be there. That imbalance, if it is there, then it should be removed. Then an analysis of the technical educational scenario in the country reveals the following type of imbalance which affect the health of technical education. Regional imbalance, I said about you, that regional balance should be there. It should not be in imbalance condition, imbalance. Now, second, quality versus quantity imbalance. I said one line prior to this slide that we should bother only quality, and definitely quantity is will come for, definitely. Once quality is maintained and quantity will be there, meaning number. If we bother about quality, number, we should not bother at all. If we are not bothering quality, then also we should not bother about number. Then imbalance in the field of studies, whatever the study, the course is, whatever the things are there, it should be in balance in nature. Imbalance between physical and intellectual resources. Here I said one word, that intellectual resources are our faculty members and physical resources are our building infrastructure. And definitely this balance has to be there, because your actual intellectual source, who are the faculty members, has to be very much respected and should be given complete, you can say, work enhanced to make the quality, because they are the particular main source of making the and maintaining the quality aspect of, and which will affect the employability. Then imbalance in graduate and vocational education. In university, we have observed in many of the cases that the balance is not there. Vocational education is there, graduation is there, but that has balance is there. That is very different concept, but imbalance in training process. Training process has to be meaningful. And at present time, many in commercialization has taken place. Many company will come and they will say this money wants and without money, this is, so that money is not necessarily for each and everything to go for this. So this balance of the training process has to be there. And quality research, we all are aware, the evidence of breaking ground, peer recognition, publication, patent, transfer of technical know-how, generating a new paradigm, and award and recognition. Here, it is very much interesting thing what I will tell you. That is the particular proposed model from a very reputed director of IIT system. I'll just come to this particular nine enablers. And here, in nine enablers, we can see that importance in the terms of point percentage. You can see that quality of faculty, teaching, learning, academic process, what we call leadership, quality of admission, alumni relation, physical infrastructure, collaboration, sport act, because nine, you can see the nine, this enablers are always and everywhere available in the institutions. But important this matrix of enablers, we can see a very interesting rank, that enablers, next column, importance, rank priority, what should be, and then percentage score on 5-point scale, and rank priority, what actually is. Meaning by, it is very clear from this chart that what is the exactly present status and what should be. Here we can see the quality of faculty first. Importance is being given 73%, 73.8. Rank priority number one, because it should be. And percentage score on 5-point scale in a survey, it is the matrix was formed 48.8, and rank priority at present in the system, it is on fifth priority. Then teaching, learning, academic process. Here we involve each and every pedagogy and whatever we have discussed prior to this, 67.8. Rank priority, it should be two. Second priority, it should be there, because We see the, when you are going for NVA and NIRF, first NIRF point is the teaching learning process of good marks, 100 marks. Then in NVA, it is having a, you can say 200 marks in this tier one and 150 for tier two. So second priority is teaching learning, where you can see on the right side percentage score on 0.5, the rank priority is 8. And leadership, rank priority, you can see the percentage importance. Leadership rank priority, it should be on third, but what actually, it is ninth. Quality of admission, it should be four, Fortunately, it is saving its 0.4. Alumni relation number 5th priority, and here it is coming to 7th. Fiscal infrastructure, very interesting that it, the rank priority should be on 6th, but rank priority actually happening everywhere in most of the places I found number 1. Collaborations, definitely we talk about industry collaboration, collaboration with the international universities abroad, and so many scope are there. It is 7th priority, but rank priority actually it's it is better in this one, 6th one. Sport activities, we can see it should be 8th priority, but present it is 3rd priority. So, then cultural activities, we can see the percentage importance 8.1. And rank priority, it's 9. It should be 9. But presently, it is number 1. I used to see many programs in the different, all over the country, you see this. So what I want to say, the particular second point, that the rank priority, it should be that first, second, third, fourth. If it is there, it can be maintained in this order. Definitely, I'll tell you the quality of each and every aspect to making the student employable, to getting NBA, to NIRF, to whatever the new accreditation system may come in the picture of international bodies, ABET and all, you all can get. There is no, but the thing has to be maintained in this dimension. Now, very important, that is a very proven and employability model. It is there for you to see on this slide. Here we can see the formula is empirical formula. You can see E equals to A big bracket that is multiplied. In that E is nothing but employability. A stands for attitude, the scale should be 0 to 1. K for knowledge, again it's 0 to 1. S for skill, and a relative weight, that is alpha is relative weight to knowledge over skill, 0 to 1. And alpha normally it is considered to be 0.6. Here what I want to say, that if we calculate or you calculate from your side, you will find it is very much viable for present scenario. If such a big bracket is multiplied with A, and if A have got a lesser value, then how E will be better? So that is a very challenging scenario for our students also, to make the A highest. If A is bigger than the bracket, whatever it is there, definitely it will be a little bit on the higher side. And attitude has got different, 20 type of attitudes are there. I'll come to the different slide. Knowledge important. I'll tell you the skill and knowledge difference here. Few years back, it was knowledge-based teaching. Now, I told you earlier that it is skill-based. Now, teaching is going on everywhere. For example, a ITI person is there who had appointed as a technician. Now, or he want to get a degree for ITI. So, what the particular college or institute has to see, that he wants 30% knowledge and 70% skill of ITI, of their own specialization. For example, engineering graduate, if I'm talking, then the same goes to 50-50. There is a proven result that 50% knowledge and application of the knowledge is the skill. Then 50% of that knowledge, once it is there, so the combination of 50% knowledge and 50% with the skill will definitely required for the engineering graduate. And here the value we can see, and the sample study of computing employability index of a group of students we have taken using the proposed model. Here we can see the last column, that is employability. So by multiplying this all, you can say A, and then knowledge, then skill, then this component of the bracket. This is the particular employability. So 43.7 is there, where 0.71 is there for attitude. Now that is the problem. Right now, each and every this campus into our organizations, or you can say in companies coming to the campus, they are saying that yes, we want the attitude of the student should be positive. Definitely positive means in a different, I will come to that slide. Employability ranges I have mentioned here. Now we see the skill parameters, I said varies from branch to branch. In mechanical, it has got different requirement. IT have different. EC, it cannot be same. In CS, it is different. I have taken the example of IT. Here, IT, you need is IT skill, listening skill, then oral communication, written communication, conceptual skill, vision, body language, emotional intelligence, problem solving skill, interpersonal skill, and relationship management. and innovative out-of-box thinking. Meaning by what I said, this is the out-of-box means it is the faculty, if I am talking, that it should not be the counted as a head count. It should be counted as a head content. If head content is better, then out-of-box thinking is required, that innovative. So mechanical aspect can make this other branches, electrical, electronics, will have its own different parameters required. Now, other continuing parameter which is required for IT branch student or CS branch student, this thing is required. Proactive approach, organizing skill, social skill, presentation skill, eye for detail and observation skill, analytical skills, driving values from data, conflict resolution skill. Now we talked about the employability formula, that is the very good model we have discussed. A is multiplied with a big bracket. Here we are the following parameters of attitude. This is not a you can say given in a book that a teacher will go and, but it is to be presented in a different way by the teacher by becoming role model, and it involves in all together everyone. Here, positive thinking and optimism, integrity, discipline, these are the attitudinal parameters, compassion, empathy and concern for the. Here I'll say one point, this point, empathy and concern. I'll tell you one thing, that if a student is there in campus, if he is delighted, then definitely your university or college is delighted. If a student or parent goes to their teacher for his grievances or problem, it is not necessary that there should be too much courtesy. It is not like, but only what they want or what the parents want, that one should listen the problem and try to be toward a human being and in solving the problem. This is the factor which is affecting a lot in campus, empathy and concern for others. If a student having a good feeling of your campus, definitely his parents, then there is a lot of delight environment in the campus, and definitely the university or the institute or the college will be in a different, very, very positive name, and the other aspect will be definitely fulfilling by default. Then trustworthiness has to be there, punctuality, whatever the management is there, we have to be trusty enough with them, and punctuality. Punctuality means everyone knows about this, nothing to discuss, commitment and passion to a good case, and enthusiasm. Always one should be enthusiastic. Now, attitudinal parameters, there are other parameters which have continued in this slide. Self-confidence, leadership skill has to be there, initiative and drive, because if we had a student of the four student for a BTEC project, one student becomes the leader of the project. In the same way, if we are a faculty member of some group a task, one will become the leader. So like that. If any work I am taking, I have to show my leadership also. Initiative and drive, cleanliness, pleasantness, emotional intelligence, desire to learn, ethical. These are the criteria, you can say, the attitude criteria. Parameter criteria which a student, I will say a faculty also, I should also have as a person like me, needs each and every should be, thing should be fulfilled in me. How to implement quality involvement, implement quality, this quality involve everyone. Quality is not just concern of AICT, MHRD, or college administration or university administration. It involves everyone, including a teacher, alumni, and financial supporters. And continuous improvement, system always looking for a way to improve process to help quality. It is a continuous process. Every time there is a improvement. And the stakeholders' involvement, every stakeholder has a vital role to play in spotting improvement opportunities in quality and identifying quality problems. Now, prior to this, we have talked about employability, quality, and this human capital. Now, Government of India in 2002 planned that to just overcome the quality issues of the education system, especially in technical education, they have introduced this term from the World Bank support, with the objective that this project will go to up to 12 to 13 years in a three phase manner. It was decided in 2002 and work, and they have named it Technical Education Quality Improvement Program. And the first program it was introduced, under which few engineering colleges from private institutions of Uttar Pradesh, only 10 were there. Finally, only 2 were given the aid in the first TQ. And in that TCUBE project, second phase introduced in a different way. They involved private institutions also. I'll come very brief on this phase two. The objective were that is strengthening the institution to provide high quality engineer for better employability and scaling of the PG education demand driven. That is the AICT taken from this particular TQ2 which we have discussed. But the objective were to be realized through the following specific deliverables. You can see the same thing what we have talked about in the earlier slide, that faculty staff development. Government has spent a lot of money in these three phases. Third phase also finished on 31st March of this year, and it is completed. Only 6 month extension for just binding up the record and all they had given. And then faculty and staff development, enhancing the interaction between industrial sector, improving institutional governance and management and administrative practices. Because see, if I want e-office, yes, e-office we are working. Definitely it supports from this TCUBE. Initiation was there, but the particular leader can implement the whole e-office concept in his university or institution. No need to move a single paper. Implementing relevant institutional reforms, improving teaching, training and learning facilities, providing academic support to weak students. Here I will come to F point, very much focused, because weak students are there. For example, we say this is a weak student, but we have to see, we have to support academically each and everything. Academic support is very much required to this particular sector of the student, and definitely they convert the medium and good students. Now, they are the different parameters which is mentioned here: modernizing library, enhancing research development, developing research interest among degree student. Here I'll say the BTEC students are being given the interaction of the different institution of the country to go see the research area. Now we are observing the changes of sharing resources through collaborative arrangements, modernizing and expanding laboratories. And the last point which I had mentioned in the prior slide is very much that a center of excellence has to be there in the current college, where the job oriented training program, yeah, job oriented, this center of excellence, I want to focus it here. It should not be like that, the equipment we are taking only for courses and all, or some sort of, it should be job oriented. For example, if I have established one center of excellence for alternative renewable energy, from 1 crore, I got the support from Uttar Pradesh government for 1 crore of establishing one center. And the center known as Center for Alternate and Renewable Energy. The focus has got, I have established 140 kilowatt power, solar power, then many things we have done. But in addition to better part is that I have signed MOU with NEDA, UP NEDA, that job oriented training has to be given in the job area of solar, fuel cell, biomass, wind, for those interested students who are interested to do the job training. That can be certificate course of 1 month, 2 month, 2 week, and trainer will be from UP NEDA, that is UP Non-Conventional Energy Development Agency. And also I have signed this UP NEDA, I had already signed this MOU, and this MNRE New Delhi. There is a NICE in Gurgaon, that is National Solar Institute Center, that the Arun Tripathi ji is there, and he's encouraged trainers they will be sending, and that particular aspect should be job-oriented training from the Excellence Center. Now, this particular slide will be talking about there were some expectations for TQ phase, but it should not be very much converted. So what happened in 2017, World Bank given this task to FICCI, that what was the outcome of TQ2? Because TQ2 just completed in 16. At that time, I worked with TQ2 also, I worked with TQ3 also. And there are certain things which were needed to be improved. So for the TQ3, I'll come to, because time is almost exceeding. So FICCI report on World Bank 2, this was there, that here, this is very important for all of us, that sectorial reform in the engineering sector will need to include private institution. In TQ2, it was very much not encouraged for private institutions. But this is, yes, in phase three, because a private college make up over 80% of sector. And improvement in this sector and sustainable reforms needs to the involvement of private sector. So definitely in TQ3, we have added, and that particular government have given facility to each and every affiliating technical university of the state for just funding the all engineering colleges or private colleges, and to improve in these sectors. And there are very enormous amount of funds were given to technical university and institutions under this particular those institution from government, if a private institution is there, definitely it is affiliated to some technical university, and technical university have been given enormous fund to spend on private college. And in everywhere, technical university have spent the money of the private college, and private colleges and the system have done a lot in improving the. You can see a number of things happened. And then what happened? Finally, once this 31st March, this year was the last day. So I am the committee, three-person committee member, as well as the monitoring the committee activity also. That particular task of the government again came to us that please go through the report of this TechCube 3. What is the outcome? And this is particularly in related to the this is employer survey satisfaction. Very important slides are coming in 3-4 slides. It is eye opener for all of us, because we are observing what industry wants, where is the gap, why students are not being taken from the industry. So for that, MHRD, NPIU, and National Project Implementation Unit form a 3-person committee, and we worked a lot for 2 years in identifying the particular correct person, or you can say company, to work for that. Questionnaire and all, each and everything have been given. And on the basis of that, what I'll tell you, the report were submitted on 31st March of 2021, and it has submitted to World Bank. Hopefully these things, observations are there, which is alarming for each and every university and college of the country, even NITs, because NIT also gets fund from TechCube. And here we can see soft skill. Here on the left side, you can see they are the things which is needed to be improved. Flexibility, entrepreneurial, reliability, integrity, teamwork, willingness to learn. And right side, we can see this is skill, engineering knowledge, basic computer skill. So although they have been informed too much in the TechCube 3, but still many industries have observed that this area is missing, this area is missing. I'll come to that side. Here we can see, in order to evaluate this one, we can see sectorial representation. Here, IT, mechanical, civil, electrical, and the others. If I'm talking about IT, we can see it includes the range of organization from those e-retail, fintech, eco-matrix, IT consultancy. Mechanical includes automobile, chemical, manufacturing, oil, gas, textile. Civil, cement, engineering, procurement, construction, infrastructure, logistics, shipping. Like that, each and every branch has got their special domain, and the very good work it was given to that Quality Council of India, that work we had given to them, and they submitted the report. And here we can see the observation is like this. Factors beyond the selection of any university or institution, normally industry prefers that, yes, they want the ranking of the institute. We can see the chart. They want the certain parameters that they will be going to the selection of the student to campus for, if the university or college have got this thing. Number one, experience with previous recruitment, that is previous recruits, whatever it has been recruited previously, what is the experience of those recruits with the particular industry, then faculty student ratio, then NBA accreditation, that I said in the beginning only, that they want to know whether the university technical courses are NBA accredited or not. Because university do not require, university required NAC only, NIRF only, and this is technical. So past relationship through MOU, if you have got MOU, so whether the MOU works for that, because we don't sign MOU without conditions. We want to maintain many conditions that this will be done, this will be, so they review also. Then proximity from the workplace and ranking of the institute, that is now new concept CAM, that NIRF mein kitna hai, something like that. The chart also see the percent and industry domains. Here's the same way I have written on the slide. Here, another thing is that we can see factors behind the selection of student. After selecting university college, employer generally focus on the skill and quality of engineer in order to screen the candidate for selection. Therefore, in order to consolidate those skill in the questionnaire, we collected responses with factors like project work, very well known to each and everyone, grades, internship with the same company, or any other relevant industry. For example, mechanical, if I'm talking, it is very much relevant for mechanical related companies. I'll tell you one thing again here, that these branches, core branches, what I'm talking about, civil, mechanical, electrical, are there after 2-3 years, they will come back. It is not possible at all to just go on them to backside. Right now they are on backside, CSIT on the front seat, but it is not happening, because without core branch, it is not possible to make, but for that we have to introduce our quality based syllabus, quality based teaching in these core branches with the support of your technology changes, of your skill related to computer, whatever domain it is there. Because if I'm talking about automobile, you know, the in coming years, Google cars, Tesla cars, and automobile area, it's so many things are going to change. Then each and everything is being command through the computer based technology, so the mechanical has to be there. But you see the falling point, any relevant internship, if a person is have get a score, sometimes they want to see these things. So these are the things on the basis of this. The industry says that we choose the university or colleges on these lines. If we find that the university and institutes are having these points in a better way, then definitely we visit. And you will be surprised to know that the industry from all over the country, they have become, we have around 3,500 industry were contacted right from each and every states. So basis of candidate selection by industry domain, as per the focus group discussion, we had observed that this was the observation that IT and IT's based students, fast learners, proper knowledge of skill like programming language, Java and all. Meaning by these areas, if a student of particular branch have got, then there is no problem of the job. Civil, we can see industry exposure, relevant internship, electrical, electronics, we can see practical knowledge, experience, exposure, no doubt, technical skill. Difficulty in screening candidate as per online survey, because this was the time there when there was some area where persons could not go, so we have done it online survey. About 10% respondent found it is difficult to recruit engineer in IT and this one IT sectors. But engineers need to be adaptable and open, flexible, soft skill. Whatever the earlier slide I have shown, that is to be mentioned. Here mechanical, we can see nearly 50% employer faced major difficulties while recruiting engineers in this sector. Because problem was this, that problem of while recruiting from rural area of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh is that they are not attached to industrial areas. Because their student, where they will go for internship? Like this, different branch specific observations are there. Just it is observation of two batches, 18-19 and 17-18. Two engineering pass out batches of TQ funded and non-TQ funded, meaning by those institutions of the country who are not supported from TQ, also and affiliated to AICT, and those universities who are supported with this, they both have been considered. Here again, it is we can see the priority, that is the mode of training by employers, normally hands-on industrial training, 34, internship, 21, gross functional deputation, classroom, like that. They used to maximum focus on, we can see 34% on hands-on. And that is a very much required, and that makes the human capital in efficient and productive manner. Here again, we can see the good slide, that soft skill, again, entrepreneur's skill needs 12.1. Flexibility comes on 10.9, creativity 10.5, 9.3, and English communication 7.8. This is the particular availability lacking most in the most graduates that you can see. They had observed, it is very clear observation from the industry that English communication is a 7.8%. Leadership skill 10.3. So if any organization or any university or any institution can look into this aspect, that this area has to be improved. Because this is the latest observation of the complete country, good industry of the country, not focused to one state. And very much clear, the English leadership skill, creativity, flexibility, and entrepreneurial skill are the right now demand. And the from the web graph, top five factors identified employers for not recruiting engineers even after visiting campus. They are visiting. For example, I've got a good point that they have came to my campus, I'll say, please recruit. But if they are identifying these areas lacking, so they say, sorry, next time we'll search. Try to just improve the students in these aspects. Now, this is the same slide. Sorry, it is repeated again. Now, the satisfaction survey says, again, for this satisfaction with the industry exposure, from the response presented above, the majority of employer, about 77%, have some level of satisfaction towards the level of industrial exposure of engineering graduate. Because TQ3, what they said, they have allowed institutes to participate, send the students on the industry, and they used to sponsor the money. Even from technical institute, private institutions went to industry, and they used to call the experts. Private institutions are being given and a lot of fund for these activities. Now coming to the multilingualism, we know that it is the last two, three slides are here. I'll not take more than 5 minutes. Here we are talking about the cultural difference, whatever it is there in the different aspect of the country, but different language see the world differently, and the structure of language therefore determines the native speaker perception of the experience. In particular, language influences the way people of a given culture speaks and other, including the with the family member, authority figures, peers, strangers, and influence the tone of conversation, the tone perception of experience, and familiarity, apnapan, inherent in Kannada among the speakers of the common language. That should be there. Apnapan has to be always there for any language, because that is the very clear. It is not influenced with any language. Apnapan feels and it can be observed only. Art and this one. Then second point, this first point, they are very, this aspect I have taken from this national education policy, basically. Unfortunately, Indian language have not received their due attention, and with the country losing over 220 language in the last 50 years. And presently only we can see 22 languages of 8 schedule are facing serious difficulty in the present scenario. Teaching and learning of Indian language needs to be integrated with school and higher education at every level. For language to remain relevant and vibrant, there must be a steady stream of high quality learning and print material in these languages, including textbook, books, videos, plays. I want to say here one thing, that if a person want to go to Kerala, and for example, a Kerala teacher is there, he had to teach this particular aspect up to 12th in the Kerala or Malayalam language, he has to learn, the book should be available for up to the 12th. No doubt, science, this physics, chemistry, maths are there, but if it can be written or if it can be given in the Malayalam language to a Keralite student of 10th or 12th, or a teacher can teach in Malayalam the subject of your physics, chemistry, math, whatever it is, definitely the student will learn very fast. But for that, we need to train teacher to teach the subject in the different aspect of the what we said. The textbook has to be available, workbook has to be available in the particular language of the state, what we are talking about. If it is there, if it can be attained, then definitely the you can say the intake or input of the student and the content of head will be easily grasped. Now, fourth, we can see to enable the key letters in a schedule, number of further action will be taken in and then with the higher education level, first to develop, teach many of the courses of the type mentioned above. An excellent team of teachers and faculty will have to be developed, that I said just now. A strong department program in language, comparative literature, creative, and definitely the degree including 4-year B.Ed. dual course will be developed in this. One very surprise thing which has been noticed in this education, that now this is the time what they have filled, and that is correct also, that imparting the B.Ed. education for each and every campus of engineering institutions. Because the teacher who has done M.Tech and joined as a teacher has to go for the training under the B.Ed. department. And sooner it will be visible from each and every technical institution that B.Ed. department teachers, there will be mandatory training program for a teacher who has been appointed as assistant professor after doing M.Tech. That 1 year course, 2 year course he has to do, then only his appointment letter will be active. Although he will be sent for training, after doing the training, he will be allowed to join. And there, such an initiative is there, that is there, which is very much helpful for particular area of his education. Then more higher education institutions in this domain will use mother tongue, local language, as a medium of instruction. That I said, that needs the definitely training and other aspect. High quality program of degree and in translation and interpretation.
That's okay, you are unmuted.
Technology use and integration. Here I will say it is a very simple thing which we all are aware that we are having a technology, we have to integrate. I will tell you very small example, that particular word, that 2G, 1G, 2G, 4G, we are talking about 5G. Right now everywhere 4G is there. Now we are talking when 5G will come in terms of communication, that 5G system when it will come. You see the 2G came in picture, then 2000, 3G came, then video call you can do. Otherwise, prior to 2000 only SMS was there. Video call, video calling, each and everything, then internet, video call, then 4G, 5G. So technology is changing continuously. 5G after 5G, 6G will be in picture. So definitely utilization and technology conversion has to be there. In the last two slides, I have mentioned a little bit, one slide, this is the last slide. That is, there are certain area which Normally, we can see that present corona pandemic has not only muddled normal teaching and learning, but also widened the digital divide in education. This requires higher allocation fund for education sector, as multiple fronts, including but not limited to creating and fostering the digital infrastructure for the seamless online education, training to teachers for adopting and learning new methods, transacting the education through digital mode training for a student, providing smartphones, laptops, and providing mobile learning facility at doorstep. You are surprised that few years back we used to say in the classroom, a student who is having a mobile with their smartphone. Sometime when I used to take class, still I used to take class in one of the section of the student 1 year. So I used to ask, what you are doing with the mobile? Please just switch off the mobile and keep here. So teachers used to say to the student, don't come with the mobile. Now scenario has changed. Now we used to say, ki mobile nahi hai, to class kaise kar raha ho? Something like that. So definitely government have initiated, and it will be observed also that support has to be there at doorstep. An initiative also needed for the development and the promotion of artificial intelligence. This is the term which is going to dominate the world. We all are aware, we all are teachers, and in the university, each and everyone is educated. So this AI is very much known to everyone, and its application for education sector. And the budget 21-22 overlooks the initial effect of current pandemic, because it was not, you can say, estimated this in such a way. Until when it will go, it is not decided. So this is probably although they have hovered in around in terms of measure the recoup teaching and learning on track, but the immediate opportunity have been missed. However, we can expect more productive initiative for education sector in future, because this area is there. This will involve the blending teaching, almost online teaching. So better to get the particular teaching through the abroad from the good professors from the different good universities, good NITs, good IITs. And why not to utilize their mental capability of teaching to the student in the remote area of Tamil Nadu or any Andhra Pradesh. And other concern area is the very much, we can see that 2021 is an important year in order to implement NEP 2020. As maximum task under this has to begin from this year only. Although 2020, this parliament approved, but these areas has to be initiated. Formation of new curriculum. It is to be formulated, training on teachers, training the teachers is required to get and train the teacher who can teach a student in their mother tongue, at least first phase mein. Fifth class, we need to see the teachers to teach each and every subject in their mother tongue, for that teachers are to be trained. And then books and text has to be available for that, to make the availability of updated books and other necessary requirement as per the NEP, because there are a lot of changes. So those availability of updated books are necessary. And similarly, 300 tasks are there which needs to be completed. Today is 1st May, and by 2022 before June, the policy of NEP to made available and implemented in academic institution throughout the country. So this is a activity which is their task are there. They are doing a lot, and hopefully it will be achieved in time. And by 2022, the complete implementation of a national education policy, which came after 32 years, will be there. So I am very thankful to all of the participant and guest and organizer of this webinar. And I'm very sorry that I exceeded my lecture for around 30 minutes. So if anyone have got any doubt or any query, please, I have got 5 minutes to discuss, so that question can be presented from the particular host. One can present, please.
Thank you so much. I ask the participants to come up with any questions and queries if they have.
Ma'am, still there are no questions from the participants. They are appreciating the presentations given by Pandey sir. But chat box, since 45% posting of the questions, they have not posted any question.
Let's start with this.
If anyone have got question, I have given my email ID. They can directly email me, and I'll be happy to reply. If anyone have got, it is the email ID. Rahul, you can inform.
Sure, sir.
If anyone is there, I'll just reply and immediately. There is no issue for any issue sure, related sir. To all the slide, whatever it has been presented.
Sure, sir. Sure.
So after the completion of a wonderful session in which we have come to know about so many things, lot of pillars, investment in education, health and training, now it's time to begin the second session of today's webinar, which deals with mentorship and upskilling as a part of NEP 2020. It will be presented by Dr. Kofi from Saudi Doha, Qatar. I request the team to please begin with the second session.
Hello, very good afternoon, everyone. Can everyone hear me?
Sir, yes.
Am I audible, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, very good afternoon, everyone. I'll not take much of the time as we already have a very absorbing session from Professor Pandey and we all learned about the NEP. So what I will do, I'll touch base upon the very basics of how it becomes after the NEP, like it's a transformation policy, no doubt about it. The new education policy is going to be there at least for next two or three decades and trying to create more empowered, more employable youths. And I always say that at different forums. The problem is not with the education system, is the problem is we are not bridging the gap between education and academia. And it has to be done. And who is the catalyst? Who will be the mentors? It's the educators. It's we as teachers, as professors, we need to ensure that our customers, and I always say that our students are customers. We need to prepare them. So what we do as Suslens, like, I don't know whether you guys can see my screen or not.
Sir, we can see.
It is visible, sir. It is visible.
Because I can't move it, it's okay. Like,
okay. Not visible.
Perfect. So what I'll do now, I'm not touch basing it. I'll not take more than 10 minutes. These are some of the projects, and I listen to Professor Sridhar, and thanks to Dr. Gandhi for highlighting that, and Professor Pandey also mentioned that there is a gap between the internships what we do. And we did last year, it was a unique program for some central universities and IITs as well, whereby we bring the industry experts and we formulated the program for the mechanical, chemical, civil, all the domains. And what we learn is actually what his findings were. Our student lacks in basics of communication. They can't work in teams. They can't collaborate. The self-belief was so low. Even I was getting the queries that I can't work with that gentleman. I can't do that. And what we did, we bring the HR head of Saudi Aramco, Qatar Petroleum. And that was really surprising for us. So what I did, first thing I would tell you guys, please, all the educators, buy this book on discovering success and fulfillment through mentorship. Because after the NEP 2020, mentorship is going to play a key role. Because the new policy, the new education drive is more focused on skill set, on the vocational. As educators, we must know how to do a mentoring session, how to do a structured coaching in terms of abilities, in terms of communications. So what we did after last 1 year, we designed it very meticulously. So you will find what kind of relationship we need to develop. Okay, so I'll jump in as Professor mentioned a lot of statistics. Can you please mute your...
Sir, you are muted, sir. Sir, you are muted.
No, sir, your voice is muted.
So please unmute yourself.
Tausif sir, please unmute yourself.
Now it's okay?
Yeah, okay.
Fine.
Perfect. So, again, I don't know, sorry, where I lost it, but please remember, like, the problem is not with the youths. The problem is how we are conditioning them. And I always say that it lies with us as educators. So what we have come up with certain skills that we can really inspire, because we are in a knowledge economy. Knowledge I can teach, skills we can inculcate, attitude we can develop. What we need to do is to inspire the kids, is to make them more character-based conditioning. And that's what we need to do, all of us. Really, we need to be the brand ambassadors as educators. And that's what National Education Policy talks about. We need to develop that mentoring framework with them. And in every educational institutions, the counseling system for handling stress and emotional adjustments. And I can tell you, when we are talking to kids, they have the thoughts of suicides. Why? And I was shocked, like in third year mechanical, third year civil, the guys are saying, I'm not doing enough. Guys, you haven't entered the job market. And they have that kind of fear psychosis. So please, we need to stop this comparison trap, the complaining trap, and criticism trap. These are very dangerous precedents, and that's what NEP talks about. Just let the child enjoy. Just let the kids enjoy their education. So vocational education will be integral in all school and higher education institutions. And I always say that 9, 10th, 11, 12, these 4 years are like the foundation blocks. They can be a bus conductor or an aeroplane. It all depends how we are building the, I would say, the soil properly, the conditioning properly. And mentoring is going to be the key, and that's what my focus is. So I just put NEP in a nutshell. I'm not going to touch in details, but if you look into NEP, it talks about curriculum and assessment. It talks about ICT. It talks about STEM. It talks about self-development through comprehensive approach. So what I did, we need more adaptability in our curriculum, applied learning. How can we bridge that gap between academia and industry? And that's what we focused on. Emphasis on skill building. And this is what Sustenance Institute of Employability is all about, whereby you come in. Our focus is 70% learning is through live projects. And that's what we did last year. And we bring best-in-class industry experts, best-in-class professors to evaluate these projects. And what we find gap, it's a huge gap. But at least we establish a baseline for those students. And when we get the, I would say, recommendations, I was surprised. They said, you guys change our life within a span of 6 weeks, because 2 weeks were dedicated completely for project evaluation, how you work as a team, how you collaborate. So this is what I said, what we focus on the job learning, the six things, the maximum learning has to be done on the life projects, irrespective of your branch. We need to find a pressing problem and what the solution I can offer. I'm not looking for perfection. What I'm looking for is the progress. The students must do progress, hands-on. 20% from our side, which is the mentoring, and 10% from the bookish knowledge. And again, the 30% role is for you all educators. You are the ones who can inspire them, install the value-based system. So this is what I always say, we offer them in these 6 weeks, how to develop that self-belief that they are at par with our European counterparts. And that's what, like, I work with more than 100 nationalities, with Alcoa, SABIC, Morgan Stanley, Maruti, Hindustan Zinc, Vedanta, and now with Qatar Gas. Here itself, I have more than 15 nationalities working with me. What I find that we are preparing more Indians as well-trained. I still remember the three idiots, but we are not well-innovative. We are not well-educated. And that's what we need to install the belief. Ki hum kisi se kam nahi hai. We are the best. And that kind of mindset needs to evolve around it. And really, I find that surprising in the Americans. One of my American colleagues, Tim, he always praises his kids like they are the best. And even they are not securing well masked, but their self-belief, their self-management, it at a different level. communication. And when I say communication, it's not English language. Please remember that. English is just a medium to communicate. What I say, effective communications. It includes active listening. It includes your email writing skills. I was surprised. I was taking some interviews. The students don't know how to communicate properly. They don't have the elevator pitch. And effective time management, especially pandemic, has given us a right time to install the self-management and effective time management aspects. Have these habits installed. We need to install these habits in our students. Problem solving. We don't need any more, Papa ye problem hai ye, mamma kya karu, mamma ye. We need to install these things. How to at least address the problem, how to approach the problem, whether it's through DMAC, define, measure, analyze, through so many things are there. Like Pareto principle, so many things are there. Just try to tell them how to use these problem solving tools, how to be more innovative. And that's what the basic crux is. The future lies with analytical thinking, active learning, complex problem solving. And when you analyze, I always say that we need to simplify. We need to make it simplify, clarify, and commit the students. And that's what the philosophy is all about. How can they work in teams, collaborations? And then last but not the least is emotional intelligence. And that's the most important aspect. And pandemic has taught us. We all are going through very unprecedented times. I can tell you, in the future, technical skills are important. Yes, I'm not gainsaying that. But if the guy is having the self-belief, if the guy is having the self-management, he knows, even I like a small things, like keeping your bed clean every day. How much time will it take? But that installed different neurons in our pathways of self-management. So please remember, the majority of the learning is from action, what we do. And it's possible, especially for the young graduates. The problem solving, give them special assignments. And they have to come up with, not with excuses, but with results. And then you guys are the best place to do the mentoring, to do the coaching, and try to build the network. I always say the king skill is not some technical, mechanical, electrical. The king skill is your network. And when we try to give them jobs, we try to connect with them. That's it. So what we cover in the 6 weeks is the theory part for sure, the practical application. And I'll show you the mentee-mentor dashboard that my team has developed. Please, all of you, send us a request to be a mentor. I want you guys, after one or two sessions, you can be an excellent mentors for the young mentees. And still, students need them. So life projects, mentee dashboard, CEP certificate. And I'm giving you one example. Like I was preparing some guys like Shweta and Deep Jyot and others for an ENY interview. And they are saying, sir, for me, most important part is my looks, right? And it's on a virtual interview. I said, no. The most important part is how you act during the interview. And that's what people don't understand. And that is what employers look for. So please remember, through your try to play with it, you can succeed in the interview. But what really matters is your value-based systems. It's your attitude towards the work, as highlighted by Professor Pandey earlier as well. So try to make a model whereby all these things are model. What kind of thinking process we have? Are we innovative thinkers? So please remember, the most important thing as educators, we need to raise the level of awareness. Why I'm saying is, better awareness for the kids, they can make better choices. And the most important thing, if they can make better choices, we can get the best results out of it. And please tell them, please fail. Please don't be afraid for failures. If they are getting low marks, it's okay. One professor was telling me, Tausif, my kids are not performing up to the peak. I said, just stop, professor. Just stop. These are unprecedented times. Just hug your kid. Really, I'm telling you, these are very testing times for all of us. Just try to be more compassion. Try to bring more. What I was talking to Professor Gandhi, and I said, yeah, we need to prepare more corporate citizens. What is happening now? We are promoting a breed of selfish students or the professionals. We need more selfless professionals nowadays, especially in next 10 years. So what I'm trying to say, please join the mentorship drive. It's must. In your community, you can do mentorship, but please have a structured way, because mentorship plays a very important role. And that's what NEP talks about. How can we make it more structured? How can we make it more organized? So it's not about, I always say, mentor is like a catalyst. It speeds up the reaction. He's a guide. And he can help you a lot. Because he will tell you your hindsight, your foresight, and insight. And what lies within us is the most important aspect. So please go to the LinkedIn. You can join our page. Send us the request. We will evaluate your credentials. Because all our mentors, it's a very, I would say, devil in the deep sea. Whenever we choose our mentors, we invest a lot. Because they are the ones who is preparing the future of India. Because your guidance, like I'll give you a very real example just now. A student come for me, his father paid the fees and whatever is there. He wants to go to the offshore platform, oil rig, in third year of his mechanical engineering. He's so much possessed by the conditioning of his, because all his relatives, the friends of friends are in oil and gas sector. Without thinking, and when he came to us, we did the abilities assessment, we did all the assessments that we have. I find out he's very good in his writing skills. And just out of curiosity, I published at least two or three papers with him. And I was surprised, he wrote very good papers. And then I asked him, why you want to go? He doesn't know. So the why is the most important thing. We need to understand why this gentleman is doing this what. And now this gentleman is doing PhD from University of Toronto with full scholarship. Can you imagine just one intervention? And I know this guy is not a team player. In offshore platforms, it's a different skill. It's not about technicalities. It's all about your teamwork, your collaboration, how you manage your stress. So please remember, every side, try to talk to persons who are the best fit. Again, I'm giving you one more example. Just now, in the pandemic, one of our interns, his father was not talking to him for last 4 months. Why? Because his father was a CA in a very big bank. He wants his kid to do CFA and other things. It's good for him. But when I understand that gentleman, it's completely different personality. He is a pure marketing geek. So can you imagine? We as parents want the best, the secure future. There is no such thing as secure. The pandemic has taught us the lesson. Try to build that self-belief in your kids. Whatever you are doing, I am with you. And that's what I need from all the educators in the students. Try to up the tempo. And that's what we need, more inspiration now. These are very testing times for all of us. Again, I am reiterating this thing. So what we did, we provided a platform. You go to the website and you can find it. So what I'm saying is, go with your gut feel, and gut feel is really very important. Go with your emotions. What and I always say, don't follow the passion only, because your passion changes with your transactions. What I look for, evaluate your skill set. Evaluate what value you are bringing. And all the employers, any organization, if it's paying 10 lakhs per month, is because the value that we add to the organization. Please remember that. If you are adding value, being a professor, being a teacher, you can earn at least 5 to 10 lakhs per month. It's nothing it's all about. And again, I'm telling, survival, paisa har koi kama lega. End mein, income or impact. What is matters is what kind of impact we put on the future generation. And that's what really matters. Please remember that. Ek aap kisi businessman se baat karoge, he can say, sir, paisa to main bhi kamata hun. But what separates us as educators from them is the impact that we have on the future of India. So please, guys, register yourself. We will train. I'm not saying we can't train you. We can at least have an interaction. How can we make you a better mentor? Because you guys are already mentors. Panel selects, matches the mentors and mentees. Mentor background, verify, you need to sign. There is no such type of all these things. So that's what my session is all about. I'm just trying to understand you guys about the skills, what we need. And please remember, 80% is psychology and 20% is mechanics in any of the engineering branches. Any of the engineering branches. What we need, the youngsters, because they are knowledge workers. And when we develop that model, we say there are three types of professionals. The knowledge workers, the rule-based workers, and skill-based workers. The knowledge workers are the young guys from 0 to 3 years of age. The problem happens, they're afraid of making mistakes at the workplace. And as per our research, every time the guy passing out from the college is doing anything, he's bound to make a mistake. So please remember that. We are training the knowledge workers. So let them fail. So that's it from my side. Thanks a lot for patient listening. I was very, very fast. So my apologies, because I know it's a time for lunch and all these things. So please feel free to ask anything if you have any doubts. Anything, please.
Now, request Rahul Mishra, sir, Dean Academic Affairs, Kalinga University, to please convey a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Vinita, ma'am. A very good afternoon, all the dignitaries and my dear colleagues, those who are present over the Microsoft Teams platform. I would like to thank our keynote speaker, Professor Dr. S.P. Pandey, sir, for enlightening us with his knowledge. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting things. It gave deep insights into the topic and also revealed some interesting facts. I am pretty sure the precious knowledge that Dr. S.P. Pandey, sir, gave us will definitely help us in our future. Thank you so much, sir. I would also like to thank Dr. Toshir, sir, for taking out his time from his busy schedule and enlightening us with the knowledge. I would also like to thank our chief guest, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Kalinga University, Dr. R. Sridhar, and the guest of honor, Dr. Baiju John, sir, the Director General of Kalinga University, and Dr. Sandeep Gandhi, sir, the Registrar of Kalinga University, for taking out their time from their busy schedule and blessed us with their kind words. I would also like to thank the management of Kalinga University, who gave us opportunity to organize this event. Last but not the least, I want to thank the organizing committee members, Dr. Vinita Diwan, the Master of Ceremony, Mr. Honey God, Mr. Salesh Deshmukh, Mr. Rahul Chawla, Mr. Gaurav Tamrakar, Ms. Ankita Nilani, who worked hard to make this event successful. Thanks to all. Thank you, Vinita ma'am.
Thank you, sir. So with this, our session has ended. It is finally concluded. Thank you, all of you, to be a part of this webinar. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Kalinga University. Thanks a lot, everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you, sir.
Healthy.